You have started a nuclear chapter. In that, some concepts completed. Introduction part, composition of the nucleus, and what are the characteristics of the nucleus, and also what are the types of nuclei. And next, we have started Einstein mass energy equation, and we discussed the formula, some examples, and also how to convert mass into energy or energy into mass. We discussed. Next, we have started a mass defect in the last class. What is a mass defect and the formula for a mass defect given? Now, we'll go for a binding energy concept. In this class, we'll discuss a binding energy. So, we can represent generally E suffix B. So binding energy EB, or we can also write sometimes BE. So short form, just I'm writing EB or BE. So generally in a nucleus there are two main constituents, nothing but called protons and also neutrons. Both combinedly will give the mass to the nucleus, protons and neutrons. So generally any nucleus, how it will be formed means because of the combination of the protons and neutrons. Whenever protons and neutrons are combined together, we can expect one nucleus. For example, if take oxygen nucleus, it has mass number 16. That means it has 8 protons and 8 neutrons. Whenever 8 protons and 8 neutrons all combined together, they will cling together or combine together, we can expect the nucleus of oxygen. But once if all the nucleons come together, how they will held inside the nucleus? So something must be required. So what is required means some energy must be required to bind all the nucleons or to keep all the nucleons inside the nucleus. But where we will get that energy means only from the mass defect. Generally, at the time of the formation of the nucleus, the sum of the mass of the nucleons is converted into energy. So that energy only can keep all the nucleons inside the nucleus. So earlier we mentioned one thing, always mass of the nucleus is less than the mass of the nucleons. For example, if take oxygen or any nucleus, we take atomic number 8, mass number 16. It contains total 16 nucleons. Mass of all the 16 nucleons is always greater than the mass of the oxygen nucleus. Both are not equal. Here always mass of the mass of the nucleons is always greater than the actual mass of the nucleus. Experimentally it was confirmed. What we can say? Mass of the nucleons means the sum of the protons and neutrons is always greater than mass of the nucleus. If you subtract both, what will get? How much extra mass is there? We can obtain. Generally that extra mass we are calling as delta M, which is equal to mass defect. That's all in the previous class I mentioned, which is equal to mass of the nucleons minus real mass of the nucleus. When we subtracted both, we'll get the delta M. So always mass of the nucleons more than mass of the nucleus. So the difference all we are calling as mass defect. At the time of the formation of the nucleus, this small mass defect will be converted into energy. So that energy only will keep all the nucleons inside the nucleus. If this mass defect is not there, what will be happened? There will be no energy. If no energy is there, then what will be happen? All the nucleons may not be inside the nucleus. Automatically they will come outside the nucleus, and the total structure of the nucleus may be distorted or disturbed. That's why this mass defect only will convert into energy, and that energy only can bind all the nucleons inside the nucleus. So the energy equivalent to mass defect can be called as binding energy. So you can write the simple definition. The energy equivalent to the mass defect is called binding energy. Energy equivalent to the mass defect is called binding energy. Or we can also say another definition. binding energy, we can write one more definition also. So what we can write another definition means, check here. For example, these are the number of protons and neutrons inside the nucleus. For example, whenever I want to break the nucleus and I want to take all the nucleons outside, something energy required. Oxygen, hydrogen, carbon, whatever the nucleus may take, it contains some of the protons and some of the neutrons, but all are inside the nucleus. So I want to break the nucleus and I want to take all the nucleons outside. So whatever energy required, that is also called as binding energy. So the energy required to break the nucleus is also called as binding energy. That also right. Or one more definition, the energy required to break the nucleus. Energy required to break the nucleus is called binding energy. Energy required to break the nucleus is called binding energy. But how we can calculate binding energy means by using Einstein mass energy equation. E equal mc square formula is there. So binding energy can be determined by using Einstein mass energy relation. So we can write simple formula here. Binding energy is equal to mass defect into, should write a speed of light, mc square formula. Mass defect into speed of light square, should write. That means BE or EB is equal to delta M into C square. Here delta M means mass defect. How much difference of the mass is there? Into speed of light is equal to, should write, C square. So simple formula, B is equal to delta M into C square. Here one important point you have to understand. Binding energy unit, I want to take a joule. But whenever if you want to take a joule unit, here delta M must be taken in kilograms, not AMU. So that's very important. Here we can write joule. Unit also I'm writing here, joule. In a bracket I'm writing when delta M is in kilograms. Whenever delta M is measured in kg, we can write B is equal to delta M into C square joule. But at delta M already we know one formula. Yesterday given, delta M is equal to formula mass of the protons, means ZMP, plus mass of the neutrons, A minus Z into MN. Correct? Mass of the protons plus mass of the neutrons minus real mass of the nucleus minus MN, which is equal to real mass of the nucleus into C square, you should write. So only delta M place I am writing this mass defect formula, yesterday given already. So this formula into C square you should write. Here also joule unit same only. Here also you should take a joule only unit. Or here only we can use one more formula also, or we can write Z into MH. Yesterday only I have given one more formula, previous class. By adding and subtracting with Z electrons, we got one more formula, Z into MH, mass of the hydrogen. Here it is a mass of the protons and mass of the neutrons in terms, but here mass of the hydrogen in terms, plus A minus Z into MN minus mass of the atom, should take XZA. Instead of the mass of the nucleus, I want to take a mass of the atom. So you have to understand the difference between the mass of the nucleus and mass of the atom. Mass of the nucleus means only we have, without electrons we should take it. If you want to take a mass of the atom, electrons also we have to include into C square. So depending upon the given numerical, we can select any formula. Directly they have given delta M and the speed of the light, use this formula. For example, directly delta M not given, one atom given or one nucleus given, like atomic number given, mass number given, real mass of the nucleus given, then use this formula. Or mass of the hydrogen given, and also atomic number and mass number given, mass of the atom given, then use this formula. That's important. Now I'll go for one more only. Binding energy B is equal to delta m into 931.5 MeV. Understand the unit carefully. Check here. Our B is equal to only delta m into C square formula. I'm writing correct. When delta m is measured in kg, we should take a joule. But whenever delta m is measured in AMU, atomic mass unit, then use the formula B is equal to delta m into 931.5. Yesterday in the previous class I have given. Show that one AMU is equal to 931.5 MeV. Einstein mass energy equation calculation given. How to convert 1 gram into energy? Correct, 1 AMU into energy. Last we got the value 1 AMU is equivalent to 931.5. Or roughly, may take 931 also. Okay, so this formula also you can use. When we measured delta m in AMU, in bracket I am writing here. When delta m mass defect is measured in atomic mass unit AMU, then use this formula. Here also we can write two formulae. Delta m plus we can write ZMP plus A minus Z into MN minus mass of the nucleus into 931.5 MeV, mega electron volt or million electron volt. It is a one formula. Or we can also write Z into mass of the hydrogen atom. So this formula I am modifying. Mass of the hydrogen atom plus A minus Z into MN minus mass of atom XZA into 931.5 million electron volt or mega electron volt. So depending upon the given numerical, we have to choose. So while reading the problem, we have to understand mass defect given in AMU or kilograms. So whenever they have given in the numerical kilograms, then use this formula. If kg not given, so mass of the particular nucleus, for example, they given 12.000 AMU given, then go for this formula. So that is very important. In bracket, whatever I mentioned, remember carefully. Mass defect kg given or AMU given. Based on that, you have to choose the formula. So that is about binding energy. But all the nuclei may not have the same binding energy. So depending upon the mass number, the binding energy value also changes. So generally, the nuclei having a more mass number, or maybe less mass number, least mass number, generally having a less binding energy. And the intermediate mass numbers are having a more binding energy, correct? So here you have to understand, roughly how to understand what is the binding energy means. If you want to break the nucleus, if you want to take all the nucleons outside, whatever energy required is called binding energy. For example, just I'm choosing here, it is a carbon with atomic number 6, mass number 12. So carbon contains total 6 protons, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Carbon contain total 6 protons and also 6 neutrons. That is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Correct? Total carbon contain 6 protons, 6 neutrons, 12 nucleons. If you want to break the carbon nucleus and I want to take all the 12 nucleons outside, some energy required. For example, it is a carbon nucleus. Inside this carbon nucleus, there are 12 nucleons. But I want to break and I want to take all the nucleons outside. Some energy required. That energy only we are calling as binding energy. Or if you want to keep all the 12 nucleons inside the nucleus, whatever energy required is also called as binding energy. So to remove 12 nucleons outside, for example, energy required is equal to 12 MeV required to remove all the nucleons. For example, I want to remove only one nucleon. How much energy required? One nucleon only I want to take, not all the nucleons. For example, inside the classroom, there are 10 students. And if I want to take all the 10 students outside, so there will be 100 joules of energy required. But if you want to take only one student outside, 100 joules not necessary, correct? That equal to 100 by 10, you should take only 10 joules enough. Here also, if you want to remove all the 12 nucleons outside, 12 MeV required, for example. And for one nucleon only I want to take, how much energy required means 12 by, it is equal 12, you should write, only 1 MeV enough. That 1 MeV can be called as average binding energy or specific binding energy. What is the specific or average binding energy means? Energy per nucleon. The binding energy per only one nucleon is called as specific binding energy or average binding energy, or energy required to remove only one nucleon from the nucleus is also called as average or specific binding energy. So put the next one heading, average binding energy or specific binding energy. Average binding energy or specific, average binding energy or specific binding energy. Average binding energy or specific binding energy. It is also simple. Binding energy and average binding energy difference. If you want to remove all the nucleons, required energy called binding energy. To remove only one nucleon, whatever energy required called as average binding energy. So the binding energy per nucleon, binding energy per nucleon, binding energy per nucleon is called average binding energy or specific binding energy. Binding energy per nucleon. Or we can define in a simple manner, one more also, or the binding energy required, the binding energy required to remove, binding energy required to remove one nucleon, binding energy required to remove one nucleon from a nucleus is called average binding energy. Is called average binding energy. In exam, any definition write, no problem. If you feel first definition simple, binding energy per nucleon is called average binding energy. Write the definition also. What does it mean? Average binding energy means binding energy per nucleon. Per nucleon means it is equal to binding energy by mass number. Whatever binding energy we know, that we have to divide with the mass number of the given nucleus, so that we will get the average binding energy. So simple problem, write like this. Average binding energy is equal to binding energy by mass number. Binding energy divided by mass number. So write E average or BE average, I'll write. BE average is equal to binding energy by mass number is equal to capital A. Any nucleus given, we should take that mass number and you may divide. But BE formula already we know, no? Whenever mass defect measured in a kg, just now I have given mass defect formula. B is equal to delta M into C square. Delta M into C square divided by mass number A, you should write. It is in joule. When delta M is measured in kg. Here delta M must be in kilogram, you should take. Delta M is in kilograms. Same model, one more formula we can write. B average is equal to delta M into 931.5 or 931 by A. But here you should take MeV, million electron volt or mega electron volt. Here delta M is measured in AMU, atomic mass unit. Delta M is in atomic mass unit, AMU you should take. So what is the use or importance of this average binding energy means? It will give the stability of the nucleus. For example, I am choosing a hydrogen. Just understand what is the use of this one means. It is a hydrogen. And I'll take one more, for example, iron. It is equal to Fe, atomic number 26, mass number 56, iron nucleus. And next time it is a hydrogen nucleus, generally smaller in size. And next time choosing a uranium nucleus, uranium 90 to 238. So three nucleus I'm choosing, but here uranium nucleus is bigger, size bigger, correct? It is a smaller. For example, here there will be one proton is there, or one nucleon. Here also there is a one nucleon, number of nucleons are there. Example, I'm taking one nucleon. Here also only one nucleon. I want to take this nucleon outside from the hydrogen atom. Only single nucleon I want to take outside. Here also I want to take single nucleon outside. Here also I want to take single nucleon outside. In which case more energy required, that you have to understand. For example, here around 1.1 million electron volt is required to remove one nucleon from hydrogen atom. How much energy required? 1.1 MeV required. Same nucleon if you want to remove from the iron, 8.75 mega electron volt required, more value. And here if you want to remove same nucleon, approximately 7.5 to 7.6 mega electron volt required. From this three, which case more energy required? In all the cases we are taking only one nucleon outside, but here only 1.1, but here 7.6, but here 8.75. Which case more energy we are using? Iron. So that means very difficult to remove from the nucleon from iron nucleus. So that's why it is a more stable, it's a more strong or stable. But hydrogen and uranium both are less stable. So because here very less amount of energy required to remove the nucleon, here little bit more energy from the uranium nucleus, but here very large value. That's why by using average binding energy, what we can understand? The stability of the nucleus can be understood. Which nuclei are more stable and which are less stable, we can understand from the average binding energy. Note on that point. By using average binding energy, stability of a nucleus can be understood or can be determined. By using average binding energy, stability of a nucleus can be determined. More the average binding energy, so simply short form write average AVG BE, short form write. More the average binding energy, more be the average binding energy, more be the stability, and vice versa. Vice versa means exactly opposite should take, and vice versa. So stability of the nucleus we can understand by using this average binding energy. So to understand clearly this one, we can draw one graph also. By taking average binding energy on y-axis and the mass number of the given nucleus on x-axis, we can draw a simple curve also that can be called as a binding energy curve. Next one, I'll draw the graph and how to note down this graph also. Binding energy curve. Binding energy curve. What is the purpose of this curve means? Here also same. By using this curve, we can understand which elements are more stable and which nuclei are less stable, or which are intermediate, that we can understand, or how the binding energy value, average binding energy value changes with the mass number, we can understand. So that is a binding energy curve. But what you should take on x-axis and y-axis? Mass number of the given nucleus taken on x-axis and average binding energy taken on y-axis. That curve can be called as a binding energy curve. So if you want to note down that one, a graph is drawn by taking mass number on x-axis. A graph is drawn by taking a mass number on x-axis and average binding energy on y axis. A graph is drawn by taking mass number on x axis and the average binding energy on y axis. Then such a graph is called, or then such a curve is called binding energy curve. Binding energy curve. So I'll take like this. So this will be BE by A. So BE by A means binding energy per nucleon, which is also called average binding energy or specific binding energy. So this I'll take in MeV, mega electron volt. I'll take the data. So MeV means I'll take a two difference. I'm taking it is equal to 2 MeV, 4, 6, 8, 10 and so on. You should take or 1 also your choice. So 2 MeV, next 4 MeV, 6, 8 and then I'll take a 10. All these are in mega electron volt. So 2 MeV, 4 MeV, 6, 8, 10 MeV. Generally highest value 8.75 or 8.8 roughly. So more than 9 also nothing is there. So for example here middle I'm taking a 9. But the highest value 8.75 or 8.8 only. So more than 9, not there. Next, here right on a horizontal line, I'll take a mass number. It will be mass number, capital A. So we can take up to 250, but difference I'll take 50-50 difference I'm taking on scale on x-axis. It is nothing but a 50. Next, we take 100, 150, 200, and then we take 250. So, 50-50 difference I am taking on x-axis. Here, 2-2 difference on y-axis. First, generally, elements are starting, we have to take hydrogen, 1H1, 1H2, 1H3, next helium, lithium, beryllium, like that. So starting mass number, I'm taking 1 around. Mass number 1 means it is a hydrogen. So hydrogen having the average binding energy around 1 or 1.1 MeV is there. So we can start the graph like this from here onwards. So first for hydrogen, this one, 1 mass number. And average binding energy around 1.1 mega electron volt is there. Nearly we can start the graph from here onwards. It is equal nearly 1 or 1.1 mega electron volt, nearly 1. Next, as the mass number increases, what will be happened? The average binding energy also gradually increases. Around up to the mass number 30, the average binding energy will be increases like this. The average binding energy will be gradually increases. Nearly I'll take around 30 here. So this will be nearly 30 you should take. Up to the mass number 30, the average binding energy increases. But later here at the middle only, what will be happening means you are observing some of the peaks like this. So some of the peaks will be observed. And up to the mass number 56, we have to take the graph gradually increases. So no need to draw the dotted line. I'll take like this. So check here, graph shape will be like this. Starting up to the mass number 30, the graph sharply increases. Not gradually, not slowly, sharply increases. And in this only it is having some of the peaks also. So we are observing some of the peaks also in this graph. Like this, around this will be mass number 20 to 30 you should take. And what does this peaks represents means, it is nothing but helium. Helium means nothing but mass number 4, atomic number 2, correct? So helium generally contains a total number of protons 2 and a number of neutrons also 2. Both are equal and also even number. So it is, you can take it as a helium. Next one, lithium, odd number. Next one is equal nothing but you should take beryllium, 4, 8 we can write. So for example, a beryllium atomic number 4, mass number 8 I am taking. So your number of protons 4, number of neutrons also 4. Next, for example, carbon, it is equal to beryllium comma carbon C, and also next one oxygen, and also neon, we should take like this. So all these elements which are having a highest peaks, what does they indicates? Generally they are having a equal and a even number of the protons and neutrons. If take a carbon C6 12, number of protons 6, number of neutrons 6, both are equal number and also even number. If take for example oxygen O8 16, number of protons 8, number of neutrons also 8, both are equal number and even number. So what we can say at the beginning, for a hydrogen the binding energy will be very least. As the mass number increases, up to the mass number 30 the graph sharply increases, and some of the peaks we are observing with the higher and lower values. What does the higher peaks indicates? The elements with equal and even number of the protons and neutrons, the elements with equal and even number of the protons and neutrons are more stable comparing to neighboring elements. For example, comparing to hydrogen, helium is more stable. Comparing to lithium, beryllium is more stable. Comparing to boron, carbon is more stable. Comparing to nitrogen, oxygen is more stable. Comparing to fluorine, neon is more stable. So the elements with equal and even number of the protons and neutrons are having a more average binding energy comparing to neighboring elements. Not comparing to all the elements, comparing to neighboring elements, that you can write. So we write first point from the graph. We can write one point, put an arrow mark and write. For 1H1, for 1H1 means hydrogen, comma 1H2, comma 1H3, for hydrogen isotopes. The average binding energy is very less. The average binding energy is very less. Average binding energy is very less. Next. Up to the mass number, next point, up to the mass number, up to the mass number 30, up to the mass number 30, the graph sharply increases. Up to the mass number, up to the mass number A is equal to 30, the graph sharply increases. Graph sharply increases. Sharply increases. Next. Next point. The higher peaks in the graph, higher peaks in the graph represents, higher peaks in the graph represents the nuclei, the nuclei with equal, with equal and even number of protons and neutrons, with equal and even number of protons and neutrons are more stable than the neighboring nuclei, more stable than the neighboring nuclei, more stable than the neighboring nuclei. So here neighboring means comparing to lithium, boron, nitrogen, fluorine. So these are more stable because they are having equal number of equal and even number of protons and neutrons. Next, for A, greater than 30 means mass number greater than 30. For the mass number A greater than 30, the graph increases. Graph increases up to A is equal to 56. Graph increases up to A is equal to 56. Increases up to A is equal to 56. And the average binding energy is a maximum. Average binding energy is a maximum. Average binding energy is a maximum for Fe means iron 26 56. Average binding energy is a maximum for iron with atomic number 26, mass number 56. But how much this value means in a bracket you may note down. 8.75 mega electron volt, 8.75 MeV, 8.75 MeV mega electron volt, capital M. So that is up to graph 56. But later what will be happened? So from 32, for example, if take up to 32, next time take up to 170 graph. It is a, for example, the number 170. The graph, what will be happened means gradually decreases. So here I'm taking it is 8, and I'll take up to 170 this one, and here I'll take this will be 30. I'll take for this one, not necessary for 30. I'll take this one around this here. So nearly from 30 to this one, the graph will be like this. So observe carefully. Means from 30 to 170, the average binding energy of the nuclei will be more than 8 mega electron volt, not less than. It will be more than 8 MeV should take. So here it will be near. Next and so on up to 30, I'm taking here this one. Up to 30, this will be graph gradually changes and becomes more than 8 MeV should take, more than 8 mega electron volt. Right, next point, right? From A is equal to mass number, A is equal to 30 to 170. For the nuclei with the mass numbers 30 to 170, here 30 to 170 means iron, nickel, cobalt, gold, silver, copper, or molybdenum, zinc, tungsten, this type of any elements you may take, they are having average binding energy more than 8 mega electron volt. In exam also, while drawing graph, you should take care. So here, whatever the highest value should not be more than 8.8 MeV, because highest value only 8. But unfortunately, for example, if you forgot and if you touch this graph at 10 MeV, that graph will be wrong. Because the highest value only we should take how much? Only 8.75 MeV you should take. While drawing graph, you should take care. Correct. Here, for example, if you touch this graph to 10 MeV or 12 MeV, then what will be happen? So such elements are not there. Only 8.8 only highest. That's why you should take care. So for from A is equal to 30 to 170, the average binding energy, 30 to 170, the average binding energy is, the average binding energy of nuclei is greater than 8 MeV. From A is equal to 30 to 170, average binding energy is greater than 8 mega electron volt. These nuclei are more stable. these nuclei are more stable comparing to lighter, comparing to heavier nuclei, these are more stable. Like iron, nickel, cobalt, copper, zinc, aluminium, gold, silver, tungsten, molybdenum or xenon. So this type of strontium, bromium, this type of any nuclei may take here to here, they are more stable. Next, above 170, what will be happened? For the nuclei with the mass number greater than 170, here up to 170, okay. But more than 170, what will be happened means, again, graph gradually decreases. I'll take for uranium, 238 I should take, nearly here, 232, 240. So here the value will be nearly 7.6 MeV I should take. Will be like this. For uranium, 92, 238. So this will be 7.6 mega electron volt. And this will be 8.75 mega electron volt. For A greater than 170, the graph gradually decreases. For A greater than 170, the graph gradually decreases. Graph gradually decreases. And for uranium, 92, 238, graph gradually decreases. And for uranium 92, 238, BE by A means average binding energy equal to 7.6 mega electron volt. 7.6 mega electron volt. So this graph and this are points important for a 5 marks question. So draw binding energy curve and write the features of the curve. Features means we have to understand and you should write like this. Once again, if completed, just I'll refresh this one. 2 minutes I'll revise. Check here. First, we have drawn one graph by taking a mass number on x-axis and average binding energy on y-axis. And such a graph can be called as a binding energy graph or binding energy curve. So from the graph, a beginning hydrogen, 1H1 or deuterium or tritium, such type of elements are having a very least average binding energy, around 1.1 or 2 MeV. Next, up to the mass number 30, the graph sharply increases like this. And up to 30, its value will be sharply increases. In this middle, we are observing some of the peaks, higher peaks and lower peaks. Again, higher and lower. So always higher peaks indicates what? The nuclei with the equal and even number of the protons and neutrons are more stable comparing to neighboring elements. So here, helium, beryllium, carbon, oxygen or neon are more stable comparing to lithium, boron, nitrogen and fluorine. Next, above the mass number 30, the graph gradually increases and becomes a maximum for iron. So you should take it is a for iron. So iron is equal to 56 mass number and the value will be highest 8.75 MeV. So you have to understand and you have to remember this point very carefully because competitive exams also important. Which of the following nuclei is a most stable among all the elements? Which is a most stable element means iron, because the highest average binding energy is there. So iron is the most stable element. And how much is the energy? 8.75 mega electron volt, or round off value means 8.8 mega electron volt. Next, from the mass number 32 up to the mass number 170, the graph will be more than 8 MeV. So the elements with the intermediate mass number means more than 30 and less than 170, they are more stable comparing to all the elements. Here example for this type of elements. What are the elements here? Means gold, copper, aluminium, silver, molybdenum, tungsten, barium, krypton. This type of elements you may take, they are more stable comparing to remaining elements. Next, above the mass number 170, what will be happen? The average binding energy graph gradually decreases, less than 8 MeV. And if take uranium, 92 to 38, the average binding energy will be 7.6 mega electron volt. So from this graph, we can classify total two type of elements. One is the elements with the mass number less than 30 and also more than 170. So these elements are less stable. Elements with the mass number less than 30 and also more than 170, they are having average binding energy only less than 8 MeV. They are said to be less stable. And middle, the elements with the intermediate mass number 30 to 170 are said to be having more average binding energy, and they are said to be having more stable. So the stability of the nucleus can be understood by using average binding energy graph. That is very important. Okay, so right, last one more. And here one quite important and interesting thing also. For example, if take uranium, its average binding energy how much? Only 7.6 MeV is there. Average binding energy of the uranium is equal to 7.6 MeV. So I'll take roughly here, understand this one. It is, for example, I'm taking one element, like say, for example, X. The mass number of this element is equal to 240. Maybe uranium, roughly I'm taking 240, correct? So here more than 170 means the average binding energy will be less than 8 MeV. It is having, for example, average binding energy is equal to 7.6 is there, roughly. 7.6 MeV, correct? It is a more stable, less stable. Less than 8 MeV means it must be less stable only, correct? It is not more stable, it is a less stable, because it is a more than 170 mass number is there, clearly less stable. I want to break this nucleus into two parts. So nearly two equal parts I want to break like this, correct? One is equal to, for example, Y, and other is equal to Z, or maybe like I'm taking M and N. So two nuclei, splitting into two nuclei. One is having the mass number is equal to, for example, 240 by 2, 120. Na? Here also nearly 240 by 2 is equal to 120 mass numbers, 120, 120. But these two nuclei having energy more than 7.6, less than 7.6. It is a parent element, for example, original element having the mass number 240, average binding energy is equal to 7.6 mega electron volt. So it is a less stable. Once I break into the nucleus into two parts with equal mass number, 120, 120, then these two nuclei are more stable or less stable. And what about average binding energy of these two nuclei, more than 7.6, less than 7.6? That you have to understand carefully. Here original element 7.6, mass number 240, it is a less stable, clear. But once if you break into two parts, 120, 120, but this will be more stable or less stable, one question. Second one, its average binding energy more than 7.6, less than 7.6. Check here, in the graph, where 120 mass number will be? Here, 30 to 170, correct? Exactly, it is middle. So middle means average binding energy will be more than 8. So that means this binding energy will be having more than 8 mega electron volt. So generally many of you having one thought, it is a 7.6 means both will be half, correct? Like three point something wrong. So because 240 mass, it is having a 7.6. But 120 means automatically the element falls to the middle part. Middle part of the graph having more than 8 MeV. So the first nuclei is more than 8 MeV, second also more than 8 MeV, and these two are said to be more stable nuclei. And this process can be called as nuclear fusion. That process can be called, don't write, nuclear fusion. Is there in 10th standard or lower standards? Nuclear fusion and a nuclear fusion concept is there. So what is the advantage of this graph means? If you know the graph, complete concept of the graph, we know. And I can select which element is easy to break. For example, I want to choose the elements with the mass number more than 30. I can choose and I can break. And after breaking, so automatically the two parts will be more stable and a lot of energy will be liberated. And that process can be called as nuclear fusion. So if you want to understand nuclear fusion, we should know about the graph. Otherwise, the scientist who want to prepare one nuclear bomb or any one nuclear weapon, so he has to select one element. For example, unfortunately, the student or the scientist don't know about the graph. He selected, for example, iron. whenever he selected iron, so we cannot prepare any nuclear bomb. So because iron is a more stable element, we cannot break iron into the subparts. We can choose uranium. By breaking uranium into two parts, it will fall into the two parts, fall into the middle part. They are stable and a large amount of energy can be emitted. So that method is called as nuclear fission. So same way, I want to choose a lighter nuclei. Like I am choosing two lighter nuclei. From the graph only we can understand one more concept also. One is I am choosing 1H2, I want to choose. And one more also I want to choose 1H2, deuterium and deuterium. Here 1H2 means your mass number around 2. So mass number 2 means they are having average binding energy around 1 or 2 MeV is there, correct? So it will be less stable. It is also less stable. And whenever I want to combine both, so both combined means you will get one larger nucleus. So it is having a binding energy will be BE by A will be less than 2 MeV. Average value less than 2 MeV around, but here after combining both, what will get? 1 plus 1 is equal to 2, 2 plus 2 is equal to 4, then it is equal to helium. Helium, whenever two hydrogen nuclei, two deuterium nuclei are combined to form one helium nucleus, but these two deuterium nucleus are having a very less average binding energy. Once if you combine both, we are getting a helium. Check here, average binding energy of the helium around 6 MeV. So once if you are able to combine two lighter unstable nuclei, we can get a more stable nucleus. So around having average binding energy will be nearly 6 will be there. BE by A will be around 6 mega electron volt. More value, no? More value. That means this type of process can be called nuclear fusion. Here we are fusing, combining both. And in the previous case, we are breaking into the two nuclear parts. So this we can understand from the average binding energy graph. And note down one more point. By using binding energy curve, the stability of a nucleus, can be determined. Stability of a nucleus can be determined. And one more, next point. From the graph or from the curve, the lighter and heavier nuclei, lighter and heavier means in bracket you can write. Nothing but 30 less than A less than, or you can write A greater than 30. And less than 170 also right. A greater than 30 and less than 170. Close the bracket. The lighter and heavier nuclei are less stable. Lighter and heavier nuclei are less stable. One more point. The nuclei with intermediate mass number. One second. Here what you have written in the previous case in bracket. A less than 30. Less than 30 means hydrogen, helium, lithium, beryllium. A less than 30 and A greater than 170. Bracket, once again, note down. A less than 30 and A greater than 170. They are called lighter and heavier nuclei. A less than 30 and A greater than 170 in the previous case. Should write like this. In the previous point, in a bracket, you may write like this. A less than 30 and A greater than 170. Write like this. Now, in this point, the nuclei with the intermediate mass number, nuclei with the intermediate mass number in the bracket, right? Between A equal to 30 and 170. Between A is equal to 30 and A is equal to 170. Close the bracket. The nuclei with the intermediate mass number are more stable. Intermediate mass number are more stable. And one more point. By using the graph, we can explain nuclear fission and nuclear fusion. So nuclear fission means heavy nucleus, when we break into two nearly equal parts, a large amount of energy will be liberated. Nuclear fusion means two lighter nuclei we can combine to form a heavy nucleus, also large amount of energy will be liberated. Both we can explain by using the binding energy graph. We can explain nuclear fission and nuclear fusion. So later we'll discuss nuclear fission and fusion, the important points and equations. So in tomorrow class we'll discuss about what are nuclear forces. What are the characteristics of the nuclear forces? One of the 3 marks or 5 marks important question we'll discuss in tomorrow class. Nuclear fission. Later we'll go for a nuclear fission concept. Okay, thank you.